While America Aged, How Pension Debts Ruined General Motors, Stopped the New York City Subways, Bankrupted San Diego, and Loom is the Next Financial Crisis, by Roger Lowenstein. Read by Michael McConnohie.
Introduction. In the late 1960s, 6 of every 10 Americans were covered by a pension plan, and it was possible to envision that soon the entire workforce would have its retirement security guaranteed. That dream has gone terribly sour. Pension sponsors from airlines to textile manufacturers to steel mills have gone belly up, and hundreds of others are now deeply in the red. More alarmingly, government employers such as cities and states have fallen behind, far behind, on funding the promises they made to their retired workers. America now faces a crisis of epidemic proportions. The fabric of the nation's pension system is collapsing, at the very moment when the population is rapidly aging. Today, America has approximately 38 million senior citizens. In a generation, the number will virtually double to 72 million. Indeed, by 2030, 1 in 5 Americans will be over 65. Who will be there to provide for them? More than 60 million Americans either are receiving or have been promised pensions. However, their numbers are shrinking rapidly. In the private sector, the proportion of jobs with pensions has plummeted to just under 20%. Perhaps even scarier, a third of the workforce does not have any retirement savings, pension, 401k, or private account at all. For workers still with pensions, plan assets are grossly inadequate. In the private sector, employers' pension funds are cumulatively an astounding $350 billion in deficit. Many employers, from Sears to IBM to Verizon, are freezing their plans to keep their obligations from growing further. Others did not act quickly enough and were forced to file for bankruptcy. The auto industry, burdened with legions of retired factory workers, is teetering on the brink. So many pension plans have gone bust already that the federal agency that insures pensions is itself in trouble. This agency, the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation, is responsible for the pensions of 1.3 million people whose plans have failed. Thanks to a spate of recent costly failures, 94 sponsors collapsed in 2006 alone, the PBGC is now $19 billion in the red and could eventually require a taxpayer bailout. Even worse, the states and localities which have promised pensions to millions of present and future retired policemen, teachers, clerical workers, and others are hundreds of billions of dollars behind on their payments to state pension funds. This is money owed by the taxpayers, and under the state constitutions, the debts must be paid. Pensions can never be defaulted upon. Thus, the deficits will require a combination of layoffs, service cuts, and higher taxes in a majority of the states for decades to come. In the case of some of the worst offenders, such as New Jersey, West Virginia, and Illinois, the cuts will likely be draconian. Thanks to their grossly underfunded pensions, these states are essentially insolvent. This program examines how the pension system went so badly off course. All financial debacles have a human element: greed or self-delusion or perhaps sheer dishonesty. In this one, retirement systems fell prey to a basic part of our nature: the urge to delay that which we find unpleasant now. Such behavior comes naturally to any child with a homework assignment, after dinner, when the game is over, and so it did to pension sponsors who deferred the required contributions. Pensions are a perfect vehicle for procrastination. In the financial world, they are the most long-enduring promises that exist. The only rival is the federal Social Security system, but there, surprisingly, the commitment is not so airtight. Congress, if it chose, could reduce or cancel Social Security benefits tomorrow. Pensions are forever. The young men who went to work for General Motors after World War II, when GM ruled the roost of American business, were promised pension and health care benefits that remained in force for half a century. One GM retiree, who died at 111 in 2006, had been collecting pension and retiree health benefits for 48 years. When he first went to work in 1926, GM's managers could not have had the faintest conception of what the company could or would be paying in benefits 80 years later. The very remoteness of the pension guarantee seduced many employers into over.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.